Welcome to another episode of Tuesday. Thanks for downloading. This is our second episode of Tuesday, where we are talking about Season 3, Episode 4, The Devils You Know. In my opinion, this is where Season 3 really seems to start taking off a little bit. We're really starting to get a lot of progression into the individual stories that they've kind of been dropping with us throughout the first few episodes, between Coulson and Rosalind, Hunter and May with Ward, and then Ward with Minnie Strucker and Andrew, the Mr. May. We're finally getting some progress on Simmons and finally learning what's going to happen with her on the alien planet, which we'll be finding out in episode 5, which we'll be talking about probably tomorrow, as I'm recording this intro and posting this episode on the day that episode 5 is going to go up, so that all of you can kind of hear what we're thinking and maybe get your brain a little bit ramped up to go into tonight's episode. So thanks again for downloading, and enjoy your episodes. And welcome to another episode of Tuesdays. This is now our second episode, and it's going to be going up pretty soon after the first one, but thanks for tuning in again. Tonight I'm joined by Jay.
Hello.
Angela.
Hi.
Paul.
Hey.
Our new Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. correspondent, Carlos.
Hi.
And Will. So episode 4 just came out, Devils We Know, and I don't know about you guys, but I really like this episode because it really upped the stakes.
Stakes.
I thought it was a good episode, too. Definitely better than episode 2. Episode 1 was solid for the most part. It was a good, like, jump back into things, but yeah. Mm-hmm. I'd rank it 1-3-2 at this point.
Yeah. And so this episode, what happened? So it kind of went through a couple of things. We had a big jump forward in the Ward subplot where Hunter, as Richie, finally got called in to go see the big boss to get ready for an op. Mm-hmm. We had a whole nother subhuman subplot where we got a little bit closer to Lash through a little bit of a joint effort between S.H.I.E.L.D. and the ATCU. And we got another really tiny, tiny bit of advancement forward on the Simmons subplot, which apparently we're finally going to get the full story on next episode.
Yeah.
I just wanted to bring up, I think that this is the first episode that we actually got his name as Lash, right?
Yes, yeah. That's true.
Still don't call him Sonic.
Yeah, so he's really blue. It's kind of off-putting.
It's just sad. Every time I see him, in my mind, it's like... Dun, dun, dun,
dun, dun, dun. Well, have you ever seen Sonic the Hedgehog? The, like, parody of it?
Sonic the Hedgehog?
Yeah.
Sounds awesome.
Sonic. Yeah, you should go on YouTube and check that out sometime.
Definitely will.
It's like the crudest drawing.
But with Simmons, so what really kind of pissed me off here is that we've had the same Simmons cliffhanger for 3 episodes in a row.
Yeah.
She came back from the planet. She said she had to go back to the planet, and now, like, she's finally got fits on it. It's like, come on, can we just get this done already?
Yeah, and that was such a cliched, like, cliffhanger. Like, it was like, okay, that's it. Now I'm going to finally tell you everything next week. It's like, ugh, come on.
I'm just kind of sick of the whole, like, everybody being afraid to, like, ask for help. You know, for something, for a team, like, for an actual team, and this is, like, beyond, like, just office politics, but, like, you guys are, like, doing, like, life-threatening things, to be so against, like, asking for help or accepting help, it's just kind of like, are you serious?
Yeah.
I mean,
team with no teamwork.
Yeah, like, I mean, you know, with what's-his-face, therapist, like, trying to talk to her. Again, people, like, avoiding therapy at all costs. Like, it's just, I'm just sick of it.
I like how literally everyone, though, is just like, hey, I'm here for you if you need it.
Yeah. And she's like, no, I don't need anyone's help ever. I have to go back to the world that I was like dying on.
No, really, I'm fine. It's okay. I'm not one of your inhuman taste subjects.
It's like, whatever, Hermione.
That sounded very like New Zealand. Like an accent.
It's good enough for now. Maybe she's not a good British person.
Next time on Agents of the Concords.
I would pay good money to see that show.
That would be amazing.
But yeah, so I'm tired of Simmons, and she just kind of needs to explain herself, and it's already been too much of this, so it's good to see that it's moving on. But then as far as like characters growing, I mean, Coulson got kind of dark this episode when he like machine choked out that new Inhuman who was just sitting there with the world's worst headache.
Well, yeah. He was getting up to like try and leave, wasn't
yeah,
he?
Yeah, but
like, he was making a it was a make a point that he was not able to, like he was in a submissive position.
But it's a very it's not a very Coulson move to be that aggressive. He's generally been nicer, and I feel like this is kind of starting us down a weird path where he's gonna be darker and maybe even a more Nick Fury like almost, because he needs to be that to be what S.H.I.E.L.D. needs.
I think that's a great way to like transform Coulson. He's way too nice to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
Let's make him dark and evil as he should be, because technically that's who he's gonna be. He's gonna be Nick Fury, just a nicer version of Nick Fury. That's all. That'd be mean.
I think he's really trying to show off to that chick a little bit too. And
yeah, I was gonna ask if anybody noticed that weird like shitty flirting that was happening.
I called that out a while ago, I think, didn't I?
Yeah, I think you called that out when we spoke about on the last episode.
As soon as it was just like, hey, sweet guy.
I one thing I've noticed on this show too is like when they're trying to like make the characters more edgy, they actually dress them darker. Does anybody notice that like Coulson's wearing darker clothes and again Ron Weasley there? What's his name? Simmons? No.
Fitz.
I always look those two mixed up. But yeah, but Simmons is like, he's like wearing darker clothes now. It's like, okay, what's this fucking high school? Like everyone's wearing like, ooh, black and edgy.
Well, neither of them are wearing ties anymore, too.
Yeah.
To show, like, hey, I'm an adult badass.
Well, so casual anti.
Coulson just can't tie his tie anymore because he's got a robot hand that doesn't work.
If they can make a robot hand, can't they make, like, a self-tying tie?
Get Nike on it. It'll just take them 20 years to make it.
People not asking for help. It's ridiculous.
It's just Phil Coulson crying silently in his office as he can't tie his tie.
Well, in the first episode, he was quoted, I lost my left hand, and May's gone, so now I lost my right. That whole spiel, too.
Yeah.
Can I also just bring up how, like, Coulson is really just half-smiling all the time?
Yeah.
He's, like, cat-mouthing.
That's just his go-to face so that you can't tell when he's lying. He's just gonna smile at you creepily forever.
He looks like a shit.
Well, maybe Tahiti did it to him. Like they like messed up his like face muscles, so he's always kind of like the Joker now, but like not as maniacal. Just like that'd be kind of funny if you're talking to him. It's like, are you kidding? Are you sarcastic? Because I can't tell because it's always the same goddamn thing.
But also regarding the new outfits, I really love Daisy's Quake costume with like the kind of awesome wrist bracers that she's got now.
It seems to like my guess is that it enhances her power because before the bracers like took away from it.
It just looks like she has bad carpal tunnel, like in both hands, or she's like an expert bowler. Like,
well, I like the costume. I like it. I think it's kind of cute. Her hair, on the other hand,
it's very X-Men 1.
You don't like the shorter haircut, Angela?
No. Paul and I were just talking about that because that's what we do in our evenings together. We discuss like shitty haircuts.
Angela's trained me in like fashion, so now I'm like picking up on things.
In the comics, she's got like a really, really short, almost like pixie cut, and yeah, I feel like that would have looked better on TV.
Okay, I'm gonna, I don't know what the word for it is, but I just think that like the pixie haircut works for the comic book because they draw her face to fit the haircut. If the actress got pixie haircut, I just don't think she has the face for it.
You know what she needs? She needs bangs. She looked really cute with bangs. I don't care how short her hair is. Just give the bitch some bangs and she'll be good to go.
Quaking bangs.
Quaking bangs.
What if they're just slowly shortening her hair every season?
And then finally she's just like bald. Like just
a patch of hair in the front.
Yeah. And the hair like wiggles when she starts to like use her quake powers. Almost like, you know, when the wire...
That'll be super anime if they do that.
And she was pretty badass in this fight scene against Lash this episode, where we got that whole subplot with the really weird power where the guy breaks out in hives if he's near another inhuman.
I'm happy that he showed up, because I've been waiting for somebody with just really shitty powers.
Well, speaking of shitty powers, did we not see that kid in the kitchen making dinner? He like floats like 3 inches off the ground and moves around. It's like that.
That's it. That's
like, oh, it's my invisible hoverboard.
That's actually pretty cool compared to the other one. So,
and it keeps you from slipping in the kitchen. That's just safety.
I'd rather float than have hives.
But the other chick had like molten arms, which was badass.
She died, so we couldn't even see her use them.
I saw her on At Midnight the other day too. I thought it was pretty funny seeing her in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Hmm. Was she funny?
Yeah, she wasn't then.
Oh, okay.
Jay, I was confused when you said I saw her at midnight. I'm like, at midnight where? Where were you at midnight when you saw this chick?
I was laying in bed watching TV. But with Lash, I think that he's a really cool character. My guess is that his powers of like looking like that and everything is limited, which is why he didn't just kill Daisy right away. Either that or he thinks she's worthy. One or the other.
I've been leaning towards the fact that he probably left her because he considers her worthy of her powers.
Now, is he a character like actually in the comics or no?
Yeah, he's in the Charles Soule.
Mm-hmm.
Right, Inhumans comic.
Yeah,
I was a Charles Schutz, and that's a different comic. Yeah, Lash is he's actually an original peanut. He's in the great he was in the Great Pumpkin Charlie run.
Just rolling around collecting rings.
Yeah, he's a background character.
Well, you know what's funny? Well, you mentioned rolling around getting the rings. You know how when he makes a hole in a wall and goes through it, I just imagine he's going into the bonus level in Sonic where he like floats around like a pinball trying to get more rings.
Trying to get the Chaos Gems.
I love how they're getting their money's worth with that effect, though. You can tell that they just paid for it once, and they're just using it over and over and over.
Yeah, that's probably what I would do.
So in Carlos and Jay, you might appreciate this. It just reminds me of anime, because it's like the same animation trick every time, and it entertains me.
Well, I'm watching One Punch Man right now, and his power is literally just punching something, and it is destroyed.
Oh.
It's obliterated.
It sounds like it'd be like a short story. You'll never stop me.
It's exactly how the anime is.
Yeah, it's like the most amazing show. Every character and villain has a huge backstory, and every time the villain is like done explaining everything, he just kills them in one shot. So you get all that information for nothing, but like the detail on every character is so amazing.
That's cool, because I think it's kind of refreshing, because you know in comics like no one's ever dead, they're always gonna come back, and if they're not dead, how many times do they break out of Arkham Asylum?
Yeah.
or Rutgers Island, or you know,
or Iron Heights, or whatever prison they're in.
Iron Heights.
I'll just add with One Punch Man too. Every character is drawn with great detail except for the main character, who looks like an egg, basically.
Yeah, he looks like Humpty Dumpty with a six-pack. Not even a six-pack. They didn't even have a six-pack.
Wait, what's that little kid show? Like Kylo or something like that? The kid with the bald head and the yellow t-shirt?
Oh, Charlie Brown?
Yeah, pretty much. He's essentially...
he's pretty much like Charlie Brown with a cape.
Okay, so back to Lash.
Sorry, Will.
No, it's okay. So Lash, and we kind of got a little bit more about his mission, because so the rash dude called him rash dude Lash. That's going to get a little confusing.
Rash and Lash. So it's like it's like Point Break.
They could have their own sitcom.
So he said that. So Coulson tried calling Lash an Angel of Mercy, and Rash called him like merciful for killing the Inhumans, and he didn't want his powers. And Lash then kills this guy, looks at Daisy, and then transforms into a normal person and walks away.
Right. I mean, he thought he was out of view at that point, and changed back where he could walk around normally.
Do we think this is a character that we've already met, or do we think this is someone new we haven't met yet?
Honestly, at first I was debating whether or not it was confirmed that he was definitely, at first I thought it was Simmons for some reason, just because, but then I thought back that she hadn't been back to our world at that point, and I thought it might have just been a side effect sort of thing from being off planet. But I don't think it's someone that's really introduced yet. They'll probably introduce him later on. And then it'll just be like, that's the guy. We definitely know that's the guy. Then at the end of the episode, it'll just be like, ha ha, definitely called it at the beginning. Fuck you, Marvel.
That'll probably be right. They're probably going to, like, give him horns or something, or it's going to be like he's masquerading as something evil, but it's just this nice-looking little old man or something.
I really want the ATCU to let them autopsy the bodies a little bit, because they haven't really let S.H.I.E.L.D. do that, as far as we know.
I'm wondering if Lash is taking something or just blowing them up.
Right. I'm curious about that also. Because he might be doing a, like, power steal sort of thing, which if
That's what I thought he was doing, like, was just stealing their powers to stay powerful.
Right. And he might be doing that to... I have a theory that he's killing them to... like, keep the Kree away from Earth, that sort of thing.
Oh.
Too many Inhumans would make, the actual weaponized thing into effect, which is what the Kree guy was saying in Season 2, that there are weapons for them. So if all of the Inhumans are activated, just makes sense, I guess, but at the same time.
A parasite to keep order?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then, so beyond that whole storyline, we then got the kind of... I really enjoyed the Hunter May storyline this episode.
I don't like how greedy Hunter was.
So, I agree with that. I don't like it, but I think that it was right for his character.
Which one's Hunter?
The Australian one? New Zealand?
The one who, like, died?
I keep calling him Snatch, because he reminds me of somebody of, like, a Guy Ritchie movie.
So, that's very fitting.
Like, even a Pikey? Is he a Pikey?
Yeah, he's a Pikey. That's totally... Yes. Thank you, Carlos.
And then that led us up to kind of what I thought was what should have ended the episode, which was, so... Ward sends Baron Von Strucker's kid, who I still don't care about, off to go get Andrew, and they pin him in a convenience store, and then the last thing we see of that shot is feet on the floor, a bloody mess, and then a gasoline exploding while Baron Von Strucker's kid runs out the door to hide behind a car.
Yeah, that was I was a little taken aback by that.
Yeah, and so the implication is that it's Andrew, which is right. May's husband, which if it is, that's like the third black guy that this show has killed in like three seasons.
Yeah, that's a problem.
So there was Mike Peterson in season
one.
He's
not dead.
Well, but they killed him for a little bit.
They keep bringing him back and torturing the shit out of him.
That's Deathlok?
Yeah, Deathlok.
He, like, his worst mistake was ever doing that thing, because he's just being used for experiments and, like, being brought to near death.
I'm just tired of seeing black characters, especially black male characters, getting turned into machines. That, you know what? This seems to be the thing. Like
psychological powers.
Yeah,
it's like double whammy.
Yeah, yeah. Like I just noticed, like
all black people in like that are here are either like cybernetic or they have electrical powers, and that dude was both.
Pretty much, but maybe Andrew Blair Underwood there. Maybe. It was a life model decoy. Angela, I lost her thought. Or you're distracting me with your beauty. He's an Inhuman.
That's
or it. He's been dead the whole time.
And he's running on batteries.
I think it's like, because originally, if you had one than more than one like black person on one show or a movie, if you had more than one, you break the space-time continuum. But now I think it's like if you have more than like two, you better shave it down because you can't.
Well, they only have one at this point now, technically.
I know. They had two, and they had to immediately get rid of the other one. So have to make up for lost time.
And so to Paul, one of Paul's points, so I absolutely agree that he's an inhuman, and I actually did a stupid amount of research while watching this episode to prove this point.
If you don't mind,
I'm going to run through what I found. One of them was when he's in his session with Simmons, one of the things that he says is that he knows what it feels like to be uncomfortable in your own skin. And I didn't go back to Daisy, but I went back to Joey in the first episode, and then in this episode, the rash guy, they both also said something about feeling very uncomfortable in their own skin, or their skin was on fire, so I found that to be an interesting connection.
Okay. By the way, if you're, like, wrong on all of this, we're going to laugh so hard.
I know, but...
valid point though so far,
and it makes sense to me. And then another one is, so since Andrew keeps rejecting Skye's candidates to join her team, I think that's him projecting because he's an inhuman. So him and May were in Hawaii, and then he disappeared, and then like didn't contact her. So I think he became an inhuman, and then like freaked out and went off, got his powers under control, came back to S.H.I.E.L.D. and started rejecting prospects for Daisy's team because he couldn't keep his stuff under control and it ruined his life. So how could any of them manage it when he's supposed to be the expert? Then I think those were my two big things.
Okay. I mean, he did say that, like he tried to do the, it's not you, it's me sort of thing, kind of, which it would make perfect sense if, he had changed at that time.
He said that that's not what it was, and that was May who called that what it was. Those were her words, not his.
Right.
But then also, so in regards to the shot, we see the feet and the blood and then the lighter on the floor with the gas just kind of pooling out. And mm-hmm. So earlier in the scene, there is a gentleman in another business suit over off to the side in the background of one of the shots. And the way that Von Strucker's kid is running out of the shop afterwards doesn't seem like someone where everything went according to plan.
Yeah,
he doesn't look really proud or anything.
He looks terrified. He looks like he's about to shit himself.
Well, you know why? I'm sorry, go ahead. No, I was going to say, I think he's upset because he let Maximus down.
Is Maximus what you call Ward?
I didn't know
what you meant by
nicknames
that one.
For everybody.
Beardy McTraderson was his nickname for a while.
Oh, really?
That kid we talked about on. See, this is that little yellow box at the bottom of.
Oh, I get it.
This is the yellow box at the bottom of the comic book that the editor's explanation, where like, you know, to see the previous episode we discussed about how that kid Baron Von Strucker's son mm-hmm. was the kid in Gladiator who looked
that's
up,
right.
Looked up,
oh who yeah, looked that shitty maximum. Little kid.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I shall cheer for you, Gladiator. That's like my favorite line in that movie.
So I don't think Andrew's dead. And I think that while it was a big shock and May still thinks it's true, she doesn't know anything else yet, we're going to see some really badass May stuff coming up over the next couple of episodes.
Yeah. I think also we don't know what the... I mean, I doubt the other villain guy was wearing fucking nice shoes and everything like that. But if we see him as a background character, that might be a giveaway.
Mm-hmm.
If we don't see him for a while, I guess, maybe. That might be it, I guess. I don't know.
I don't know who I am anymore.
Yeah.
I don't know, but I'm calling that's what we're probably not going to find out for two or three episodes, but that's my prediction.
Okay, so are we on to how shitty Simmons is now?
Yeah, we can talk about how shitty Simmons is.
Don't look at my lab stuff that's being left on a table that's marked classified.
Yeah,
even though you're the head of the science division, you dick.
Don't leave it laying around. That's just spy espionage 101.
Jay's so angry about this.
I hate her.
No, and like, why is she's telling like freaking Blonchick
Bobby
like her business and like leaving Fitz like the one guy who's like really like trying to like empathize with her, she's just like, fuck you, you took me to dinner, I'm not telling you shit. It's like, what is her fucking deal?
Ungrateful. He saved her life so many times. he sacrificed himself and like made himself a like he had mental retardation of some sort and like was not functioning right as a human being just to make sure that she was okay. And yeah. She's still just like, fuck you.
Yeah, I'm
a terrible person.
So totally. just to play devil's advocate.
No.
Just because.
No.
So in this episode, I kind of enjoyed the scene where she got psychoanalyzed, even though I think they're using the psychoanalyzing thing a little bit too much.
Because like it's just like, oh, we need a scene where they don't accept help some more.
Mm-hmm. But she gives up that one thing where she gave up hope. She actually gave up hope that she was ever going to make it home, which I think. So, I mean, that changes a person. In a character, that absolutely changes a person. Then she started looking for reasons to live on that planet. And that's what she's focused on right now, because she's got actual, like, regret about not getting something done over there, which is shitty, and she's a terrible person for cutting fits out of her life, and I hate her for it. But she literally gave up her hope, and that's a fucked up thing to have to do.
Yeah, I still don't care. I'm sorry. I still don't care.
Fine. I'm right there with you. I just... Okay. It sucks, but she can stop sucking a little bit faster than that.
Not from what I've heard. Anyway, So, I don't know if I'm misremembering this or not, but did she mention that she was being hunted on that planet?
She did, not in this episode, but I think in last week's episode.
Right, but it was mentioned. Yeah. So I'm really curious as to what she was being hunted by. I don't know if it was like the other creatures on the planet, because obviously
we don't know
that there. Could be a thing, but if it's a life form or being or something like that, and she had to save other life forms or beings, then she might have some sort of responsibility toward that.
What if it was every other person that's been sucked up by the stone, and it's just a place where people go and time kind of stops?
It's like the Hunger Games.
Well, that kind of makes sense in the sense that the head wound that she had received in the end of last season was still there at the beginning of this one, like, mm-hmm. and it still looked fairly fresh, unless she just reopened the wound, which I doubt, but I guess it's a possibility. It's a dimension, different world.
Isn't there a rumor going around that she's in Asgardian hell?
So, yeah, there's a theory about that, because some Redditor who was getting their sister on board to the show or something noticed in, I think, episode 9, there was a hologram. It was the episode where the villain was this guy who kept shifting in and out of, like, our universe or teleporting somewhere else. And he was, like, creepily protecting his coworker.
That was a total X-Files episode. That was very reminiscent of X-Files.
Yeah, it was. And then eventually they track to where he's going, and it's this big red hologram, because that's how holograms look, of a planet with like two big structures behind it that look very much like where she was at the beginning of this season, and she referred to it as hell in that prior episode.
So is it a way that when he was teleporting, he was like momentarily passing between hell or...
Mm-hmm. Which might even end up being how she gets back, or maybe... If they use him again somehow.
You know, Marvel has told a very similar storyline in X-Men Evolution when Nightcrawler was bamfing, mm-hmm. he was briefly passing through like a demonic dimension.
I thought that was always his power.
Right, but I'm just saying, like, you know, it's kind of again in a television series.
Mm-hmm.
Just
saying. Yeah. No. Well.
All right, good talk.
Nightcrawler is better than this other guy anyways. I've always loved Nightcrawler.
Cool character.
Yeah.
Super underrated.
Nightcrawler. Our favorite overly Christian devil. So I really enjoyed this episode. I think it was better than the past few. And I'm really looking forward to see what they do, because I really want to see some kind of terrible things happen to Simon on this alien planet.
Yeah. When Fitz analyzed the scent, didn't they say that it was like 1,500 years old or something like that?
Mm-hmm.
So if that's a time standstill sort of thing, then that kind of makes sense. Which, when they were analyzing how the guy was traveling between dimensions and stuff like that, did they have any, like, samples or anything like that from the other world that they had got to prove that it was that dimension?
I don't think so.
Because I feel like if there was sort of some sort of sample at all, then it would have a similar match to what they had found on that planet.
Hmm. It's been a while since I've seen it. The internet did all my legwork, all the legwork on that one for me.
Fair enough.
Yeah, so anyone else have any prevailing theories?
No theories really, but I think the writing is certainly getting stronger. You know, it's funny, the first time I watched the episode, for some reason it didn't grab me. Honestly, Blair Underwood's death did, but I think I kind of actually enjoyed it the second time around, and that kind of always seems to be my kind of feeling on S.H.I.E.L.D. First time, I'm like, and I watch it again, and I'm like, oh yeah, it's pretty good. I don't know why, like, I don't know. Maybe I'm like predisposed to like judge it because of season one, that I'm always like, this sucks, and I watch
like, just married to me, and we're always like negative Nancy-ing on everything.
I also think it works better binging, which even though it's not written to be binged, it's the story is halfway told between like episodic and binge worthy television.
No, I think you're right on that, Will. Yeah, because I binged one and two, and yeah, so three's. Maybe that's why I have a hard time getting into season three.
Because,
because watching it once and then when you watch back to back, it gets a little better. Did we talk about any kind of theory that, like, so she's on a planet, not a moon, right? Or could she be on a moon? So I'm thinking it'd be kind of cool if she was on the same moon as, like, Black Bolt and Medusa and Lockjaw are in.
So it's unclear they haven't given it a name or a type. But it's unlikely that it's anywhere where the Inhuman royal family is with Adelan, because that's never left Earth. It's gone to the moon, or sorry, left Earth area. It's been on the moon. It's been on Earth. It's never been anywhere else.
Okay. So if they're doing. Well, they are doing Black Bolt and all that, so they're definitely somewhere in the neighborhood of Earth.
Mm-hmm. And I've actually been reading a lot lately about how poorly the movie and TV sections of Marvel are working with each other. So Perlmutter and Jeff Loeb are still in charge of TV, and Feige's in charge of film. So we've already seen this with Daredevil and Night Nurse. Rosario Dawson couldn't be Night Nurse.
Right.
Apparently Feige's really not too pleased, I think might be a good way to say it, about the Inhumans being in the TV show. Because the TV show keeps wanting to get even just like the slightest hint to the royal family, but Feige keeps shutting him down.
Okay.
And then on the other end of the spectrum, you have Perlmutter being like the cheapest guy ever. And I was actually thinking during this episode, it's funny that the gunfights are actually real. They seem real because they're not, like, constantly firing on the same magazine, but I'm guessing it's just because they actually have a budget restraint on how much fake ammo they can use.
Yeah, it's so funny when you... What's his name? Perlmutter?
Perlmutter, yeah.
That sounds like an insult. Like, you Perlmutter. Like, that's a new insult if you're, like, a cheapskate. You motherfucking Perlmutter.
I can almost guarantee you that that's probably an actual term in the industry.
Well, you know, it's sad because, you know, while there's Netflix and there's the ABC and like the films, it's all part of the same family.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like it sounds like it's just like bad, like, I don't know, like cousins fighting at Thanksgiving dinner. You know, like it's just like
cousins fighting for the will.
Yeah.
And I actually also read that Perlmutter and Jeff Loeb were actually they were the ones that were pushing for the comic side to phase out the X-Men and start making the Inhumans more popular so that they could make the shows about it, where Feige apparently just was waiting. He was waiting to get the rights back. He had multiple plans for every scenario where if they didn't get Spider-Man and they didn't get the Fantastic Four and they didn't get X-Men, this was how they were going to do it. But he had backup plans for everything. That's how they were so ready to get Spider-Man in. And he was just waiting to get the X-Men back. He knew it was going to happen eventually.
No, I totally agree with you, Will, that I think he's got a backup plan. And I said that about Spider-Man 2, actually, that I believe that there were a few different scripts of Captain America that existed, that, like, one that was with Spider-Man, one without, and I'm pretty damn sure there is a script that existed without Tony Stark in it, because I remember very, very early on when they released the titles, at one point it was going to be called Captain America, like, Serpent Society, that was going to be the thing, but when they roped in Robert Downey Jr., they're like, well, we got Downey Jr., we're totally doing fucking Civil War.
Yeah, and apparently that deal almost, like, ruined the studio, because now they're paying, so, like, out of the entire budget, or maybe this might be for Infinity War. So Infinity War has $1 billion budget, $400 million of it is just the actor's salaries, and they had to, like, renegotiate, and that's due to them having to renegotiate RDJ's contract because they wanted to shove him in Civil War.
Well, didn't Robert Downey Jr. also, like, try and guarantee himself like 40 minutes of screen time or something like that too?
I don't know. He's got so much leverage over Disney. His contract for Iron Man locked him so much money for anything he does for them. He was like, he's part of the reason why they can't pay, they pay so shittily to everyone else, which has caused a lot of other problems. Because he, like, it's like how George Lucas made out like a bandit on the Star Wars merchandising. Like, that's essentially what RDJ did for Iron Man.
But George Lucas donated the money that he made from Star Wars, didn't he?
To education.
Yeah. So
the money he made off the profits, or the money he made off the merchandising?
Just from selling the rights of Star Wars.
Yeah. So
he donated that. Or a large percentage of it or something like that.
Yeah, because he made all his money off the toys. That was where George Lucas was a genius.
Good for him. do you think that Jessica Jones might be influenced by Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. because they're going to cross over?
No, they're not going to.
Okay.
Maybe, but they might
reference each other at some point, or something.
Not anytime soon. In other news, so we're recording this the day before the Jessica Jones trailer comes out, so there is a Jessica Jones trailer coming out tomorrow, which should be pretty dope to watch.
Yes, indeedy.
So you'll have to definitely tune in to the next episode of Wednesday, where I'm sure we'll be talking about it.
Oh, yeah, we'll be talking about that Star Wars trailer, Back to the Future Day, all that fun stuff.
Yeah, so definitely keep on watching. Hit us up on Facebook or our website to let us know what you think about our theories, if you have anything else, what your favorite moments of this episode was.
We'd ChronoSpeakeasy.com.
Yeah, ChronoSpeakeasy.com, ChronoSpeakeasy Facebook, ChronoSpeakeasy Twitter. We're on the Instagrams. Check us out. Let us know what you thought. And in the meantime, enjoy your episodes. Enjoy your episodes. Enjoy your episodes. Enjoy your episodes. Enjoy your episodes.